Hello everyone, we move on to our next module, which is on module 7. We are now on compressibility on soil. Before we discuss the concept and principles for this module, let us try to identify the learning outcomes. So again, on the module, the students are expected to differentiate the value settlement profile for foundations, identify the equations to calculate elastic settlement, understand the process of consolidation, learn about one-dimensional laboratory consolidation test, understand bond ratio pressure plot, understand the difference between normally consolidated and over-consolidated planes, learn some more information about the conventional consolidation test. You have to understand how the sorbance affects the bond ratio pressure relationship, calculate settlement from one-dimensional primary consolidation, determine some correlations for the compressive index, determine some correlations for the swell index, learn about secondary consolidation, learn how co-consolidation happens over time. So, identify some methods to determine the coefficient of consolidation, understand how the consolidation settlement and their foundation is calculated, identify some methods to speed up consolidation, understand why precompression is used. So basically, we are now on compressibility of soil. So meaning to say, when you talk about soil compressibility, it is the capability of a soil to decrease in volume when subjected to a mechanical load. So basically, when a soil is subjected to compressibility, meaning to say, when you try to compress the soil, what will happen to the soil? It will decrease in volume due to the mechanical load that was being applied. So the process that describes the decrease in soil volume, which is soil densification. So meaning to say, when you try to decrease the volume of the soil through compression, that is what we call soil densification under an externally applied load, and that is what we call as compression. So the process that describes the decrease in soil volume, which is soil densification under an extremely applied load, is called compression. So simply, consolidation refers to the compression of saturated soil, because we are going to encounter the term consolidation. So when you talk about consolidation, it is the compression of saturated soil under steady pressure, and it is awkward as a result of water expulsion from the soil void. So we need to say, when consolidation is the process of compression of saturated soil under steady pressure, and during consolidation, the water is being expelled from the soil sample. So compressibility and consolidation of soil are crucial parameters required in the design consideration. So when a soil mass is subjected to compressive force, of course, it will decrease in volume, and it will give us an amount of settlement. So, meaning to say, we try to compress the soil, basically, it will decrease in volume, and there will be an amount of settlement. Amount of settlement, meaning to say, it will go from the original position of the soil sample, it will go at a certain height, it will go down. So, that at a certain distance from the original surface, and that is what we call settlement. The property of the soil due to which a decrease in volume occurs under compressive force is known as compressibility of soil. So the compression of soil can occur due to compression of solid particles and water in the voids, compression and expulsion of air in the voids, expulsion of water in the voids. So basically, as mentioned, consolidation of soil, because we're going to have encounter that one, the compression of saturated soil under steady static pressure is what we call as consolidation. So it is generally related to fine-grained soil such as silt and clays. For coarse-grained soil, such as coarse-grained soil, we have the sand, the gravels, they can also undergo consolidation, but not as much as faster rate due to their high permeability. So meaning to say, saturated clays consolidate as much slower rate due to their low permeability. So meaning to say, for For this one, the saturated clay consolidate in a much lower rate because of their low permeability. So the process of consolidation is often confused with the process of compaction. So we should not be confused with the process of consolidation to the process of compaction, because compaction increases the density of unsaturated soil by reducing the volume of air in the voids. However, when we talk about consolidation, it is a time-related process of increasing the density of saturated soil by draining some of the water out of the voids. So that's the difference between consolidation and compaction. So when you talk about saturated soil layer that is subjected to a stress increase, the pore water pressure is increased suddenly. So you have to take note that in sandy soil that are highly permeable, the drainage caused by the increase in the pore water pressure is completed immediately. So the pore water drainage is accompanied by a reduction of the volume of the soil mass, which result in settlement. So because of the rapid drainage of the pore water in sandy soil, elastic settlement and consolidation occur simultaneously. So when a saturated compressible clay layer is subjected to a stress increase, elastic settlement occurs immediately because the hydraulic conductivity of soil, of clay rather, is significantly smaller than that of the sand. So the excess pore water pressure generated by loading gradually dissipates over a long period of time. So the associated volume change, that is, the consolidation in the clay, may continue long after the elastic settlement. So the settlement caused by consolidation in clay may be several times greater than the elastic settlement. So we have let's move on to contact pressure and settlement profile. So we have here elastic. Okay, we'll talk about elastic or immediate settlement of a foundation. Denoted by S of A, it occurs directly after the application of the load without change in the moisture content of the soil. So meaning to say, for example, you have a ground surface and then you try to construct a certain structure immediately on the immediately on the application of the load due to the structure that is being built, there is the occurrence of elastic or immediate settlement, but there is no change in the moisture content of the soil. So the magnitude of the contact settlement will depend on the flexibility of the foundation and the type of the material on which it is resting. So the relationship for determining the increase in stress due to the application of line load, strip load, embankment load, circular load, and rectangular load were based on the following assumption. So the load is applied on the ground surface. The loaded area is flexible. The soil medium is homogeneous, elastic, isotropic, and extends to a great depth. So we have here an illustration for elastic settlement profile and contact pressure in clay. So I mean to say, we have a clay foundation. When you try to apply a certain pressure, a certain force, what will happen, how it will settle, what will be the settlement profile. So the first one is a flexible foundation. So you have here the settlement profile of the flexible foundation. The second one is a rigid foundation. So you have here a rigid foundation. So this is the settlement profile of the rigid foundation. You have to take note that for a perfectly flexible foundation resting on an elastic material such as saturated clay, so we need to say for this flexible foundation, our soil is saturated clay. So the foundation is subjected to a uniformly distributed load, the contact pressure will be uniform and the foundation will experience a sagging profile. So if you have a flexible foundation such as saturated clay, this will be the settlement profile. So it will have a sagging effect. It will have a sagging profile on our settlement. So the second one is a rigid foundation. For a perfectly rigid foundation resting on a ground surface subjected to a uniformly loaded load, the contact pressure in the foundation settlement will have this kind of settlement profile. So meaning to say, the foundation will undergo a uniform settlement and the contact pressure will be redistributed. So for this one, you have a perfectly rigid foundation, so it is subjected to a certain load, and this will, the settlement profile will have a uniform settlement profile illustration. So this illustrates a uniform settlement for the settlement profile for a rigid foundation. So the settlement profile and contact pressure described are true for soils in which the modulus of elasticity is fairly constant with depth. So that's why we have now an illustration for the elastic settlement profile and contact pressure in sand. So we need to say our foundation is a sand. So this one is, in the case of cohesionless sand, the modulus of elasticity increases with depth. Additionally, here there is a lack of lateral confinement of the edge of the foundation of the ground surface. The sand of the edge of the flexible foundation is pushed upward, and the deflection curve of the foundation takes a concave downward shape. So this one is a flexible foundation, wherein the sand of the edge of the flexible foundation is pushed downward, and the deflection curve of the foundation takes a concave downward shape. So you have a concave downward shape for a flexible foundation for this illustration. The second one is a rigid foundation. The distribution of the contact pressure and settlement profile for a flexible and rigid foundation resting on the sand is subjected to a uniform loading as shown in this figure. So for this one, you have a rigid foundation. So the elastic settlement profile, it illustrates a uniform settlement for a rigid foundation for this illustration. So relations of elastic settlement. So we have here figure 11.3, which shows a shallow foundation subjected to a net force per unit area, which is equal to delta sigma. So let a Poisson's ratio of the modulus of elasticity of the soil supporting it to be mu sub s and e sub s respectively. Theoretically, if the foundation is perfectly flexible, the settlement may be expressed as this through this equation. So you have to take note this equation is used for a foundation that is flexible. So to compute the settlement for a foundation that is perfectly flexible, you can use this equation. So you just have to take note of the parameters present on this equation. So you have the net applied force of the foundation, the Poisson's ratio of the soil, the average modulus of elasticity of the foundation measured from z is equal to 0 to about z is equal to 5b. B prime is b over 2 for the center of the foundation. We have b for the corner of the foundation, and I sub s is the shape factor. So this is the illustration or the figure that we're talking about. This represents the elastic settlement of flexible and rigid foundation. So for this one, as mentioned, as illustrated a while ago, this is for this settlement profile for a flexible foundation. This one is the settlement profile for a rigid foundation settlement. For the shape factor, you have the formula. F sub 1 plus 1 minus 2 mu sub s all over 1 minus mu sub s times F sub 2. To solve for F1 and F2, you have this equation. And to take note, A sub O, you have even with this equation, A sub 1 is F2. And you have to take note that I sub F is our depth factor, which is a function of dF over d, mu sub s, and l over d. You have to get the value for n prime and n prime so that you can solve this a sub o, a sub 1, and a sub 2. But it's necessary to compute for f's 1, f sub 2, which is needed in the computation for the shape factor. So alpha, the factor that depends on the location of the foundation where settlement is being calculated. So the calculation of settlement of the center of the foundation, when alpha is equal to 4, you have m1 and n sub 1, given by this equation. When the settlement is at the corner of the foundation, alpha is equal to 1, so m1, m prime, and n prime is equal to this expression. So this one, for the value for f1 and f2, we need the value for m prime and n prime, which is given on this table 11.1 and table 11.11. 11.2, so that we can solve for our F2 and F sub.